entertained? Are you not entertained? Is this not why you are here?
Welcome to the Rational Mill. I am the host, Will Tomassi. Today we're going to be talking about truth about chivalry. Do you think chivalry is dead? Everyone says that, right? Why do they say that? I know, this sounds like old school stuff, but I think I'm going to go places that a lot of you guys are going to be kind of uncomfortable with me going today, so stick around. Chivalry is not dead. Does that sound optimistic? Really? No, stop. Stop. No, okay. All right. There we go. Okay. I think that's one of my favorites. I think that's my favorite intro. I've got three intros now. I don't know which one I should standardize. I like them all. They're all like children, you know, for me. Some of them succeed, some of them don't. You still love them, right? Okay, so guys, I'm glad you guys enjoyed last week's show, or excuse me, last Sunday's show. Sunday was a really, really well-received show, let's just say. I went over on that one, and I know I keep going. I keep saying, I'm only going to do an hour 45. No, I do. I have heard your requests, though. I do need to carve out a little bit more time for you guys with Q&A. So you're already on it. See, yeah, we're going to talk about that today, too. We're going to get into what chivalry is all about. I think the funny thing about this is, I'll have to give you the background first. Why I am going into this topic today. Nobody actually threw this at me. I did this myself because the concept of Westernized chivalry is a major theme of book four, and there is an entire chapter, a very robust chapter in book four, because chivalry, I think, is an underappreciated aspect of the feminine imperative today. And so I want to get into a little bit of the history of chivalry and see what you guys think about it too. I was going to use the Dave Chappelle comedy sketch. I know people are going to say, why didn't put Dave Chappelle on there?
Gotcha, bitch.
Now, there you go. Okay. So, I don't want to get a flag. So a copyright flag. I wouldn't get a copyright flag. I just wouldn't be able to monetize anything. And I'm actually trying to dial my channel in a little bit better than I have. I'm actually paying some attention to it recently. So usually this is just sort of my outlet to kind of touch base with all of you guys. Let's see, what'd you say? Did your homework and watch Mrs. Doubtfire. It seems the movie went from comedy to a dark tragedy. Yeah, it's because you look at things differently. You look at that. That's going to be, we'll talk about that today, oddly enough. The principles and the things that you used to look at things, people will say, well, that's my blue pill way of thinking. And I've sort of cut myself away from that. And yeah, you probably have, but you want to know something that's even darker about that, about Mrs. Doubtfire and, movies like Pretty Woman and, Dirty Dancing, what's the other one? There's anything that has like sort of a romantic base to it. There's a real, like when you become red pill aware, and after today's show, you will have, I don't want to bum anybody out. Like I'm really not trying to like depress you or anything like that, but you will have a different perspective of that kind of stuff. Certainly when you become red pill aware, but also when you understand, what the basis is of romantic comedies, why do they work? Why do we, what are the expectations we have from a romantic comedy or from anything that's romantic, quote unquote romantic? And I'm going to talk about that today. So I wanted to, let me just pick up where I left off. I'm like I said, there's a very thorough chapter on chivalry in my upcoming book. I'll just tell you the title of the chapter is called the Religion of Chivalry, or Chivalry as Religion. I'll probably rename it something else, but you have to have a kind of a, I don't want to give you guys, I'm not a historian, but I kind of have to give you guys a little bit of history in this particular stream. Because you have to know where we were and how we got to where we're at right now, and why concepts of chivalry are so important to us, or what we think of as chivalry right now. That's why I was kind of joking around with everybody, and I was kind of course I try to poke the bear a little bit when I'm teasing a show. Of course, when I was looking up, I did a little bit of a research for this video actually, and of course I go and I look and I say, okay, look up chivalry, like key terms like chivalry, or is chivalry dead, or romantic comedies, or whatever. And then, of course, the top return, at least on Google and on YouTube, is chivalry dead? Or what is it? The Dave Chappelle sketch. He's got a little bit in one of his comedy sketch, or one of his stand-up things, and he goes into saying, you know, chivalry's dead, and it's because women killed it. And I thought about that for a minute, and I go, well, I get where he's coming from, and it's funny. Because he is outlining the expectations we have, or women have, of men. And I will admit that before I did this kind of research and I dug deeper into this for this book, I would have laughed at it. You know, I would have been like, oh, that's funny. Ha ha ha. You know, women expect this old social contract, or this old way, you know, this old way of this old traditional form of masculinity. And they expect all the benefits of that. And we were just talking, like we were on Rule Zero, and we're talking about how it is that, like, in the post-virus world, or like as soon as there's like a global crisis or the pandemic comes up, then suddenly women go from being these empowered, strong, independent, you know, yes girls, to being a little bit more attractive. Or at least this was a presumption. Okay, this isn't how it played out, but the presumption was that, ha. You know, what is it?
Gotcha, bitch.
Yeah, you're gonna go from being a feminist to being June Cleaver. You're gonna go from being a strong, independent woman who's got a job in HR or you know, publicity or whatever it is, and that's gonna dry up, and now you're gonna start looking for a guy who's a plumber, right? Or a guy who has a trade, or a guy who's in STEM fields, and those guys are suddenly gonna be much more attractive, and then MGTOW's, yay, we win. Well, I thought about that and I go, why would that be the presumption? Why would we say, well, that's what they're going to go back to? And then that made me think about some other things, which was, and I've written about this before, and maybe this is something I need to sort of reconsider, because I tend to look at things in this way. I tend to look at things from like sort of the before the sexual revolution and then after the sexual revolution. And then after the sexual revolution is where we get things like the feminine imperative, right? And that's where we get militant feminism. Feminism has been around since organized feminism has been around since 1848. That's when the Seneca Falls thing went on. And I forget the name. I think it was Articles of Feminism. It was like where the suffragettes started, basically. And that was a worldwide thing, too. I think people don't really realize that this, I mean, it mainly took place in like westernized countries like the UK and the United States at that, you know, this is Tom during the Wild West. If you guys have played, was it Red Dead Redemption number 2 or something like that? Like they have like the suffragette woman that's in there. And I like people were like when that first came out, that game first came out, people were like doing videos of like beating up the suffragettes or something. And then they would put them out. And then of course, I think YouTube was banning those for a little while. But at least it's historically accurate. You know, they were right. They, you know, during about that time period, that era, that's when it got started. But feminism has been around for a real long time. And it used to be that I think the idea was that that there's this old social contract that happened that was sort of in place before the sexual revolution. And yeah, they're right. I'm right. I think so anyways. And that's how I've written about it. And I think that one of the errors, or one of the things that I guess confuses and frustrates guys, is that when it comes to dealing with women, it seems that women still want this old school, old way, old chivalry, right? And that's why women complain about that. I, again, doing my homework for, and I do lots of homework, doing my homework for this show, I'm looking at articles. And of course, all I do is just type in, you know, what I want to name the show or what I want to talk about. And then I find articles on it. And then I'm finding article after article about primarily from women saying, oh, you know, men aren't men anymore. And they won't man up and they won't take the responsibilities. And they don't, they won't pay for dates, right? That's the whole thing. Chivalry is another, I think the biggest conflict in modern times right now, chivalry is equated with guys having to pay for dates or not paying for dates. Should we be egalitarian equals, and is it all even Steven, and should like the guy pay for a date and then a girl pay for the date, or they pay halves or whatever? And there's, for most women, that rubs women the wrong way. And like guys today will say, I'll never pay for a date because I don't want to be a foodie call, right? Instead of a booty call, I want to be a foodie call. And there are forums, online forums, as you might guess, where women get together and they figure out more efficient, optimized ways to, sort of string along and get good free food out of guys. And women will openly admit that, just like open hypergamy is a thing. Well, you know, now that open hypergamy is a thing, sure, why not openly expressing how you go about manipulating a beta male to get food? He thinks I like him. I know I got to let him down easy, but the food is so good. He takes me to steakhouses. It's great. Oh. And then, you know, she's taking pictures of, you know, whatever, seared scallops. I mean, think about that, man. She's ordering the lobster. That you're probably a foodie call. But I want to talk about that. Like, why is that an expectation? Why does it rub women the wrong way when a guy doesn't pay for a date or isn't responsible for entertaining her? We talked about that before. I kept saying that, you know, men are naturally hardwired in our part of our evolutionary mental firmware to want to show off in front of women. Like there's an element of that. All of this, there's a biological aspect. There's a evolutionary aspect to chivalry as well. So I was digging into this and I'm looking at these articles, and most of them are like, oh, those are women complaining that they can't get a guy who's a real man. And a real man is the guy, of course, who takes care of her kids. The real man is the guy who is pretty much the idealized beta provider. It's not so much the guys that she was having fun with in her party years. Rich Cooper will occasionally, well, actually I should say quite often, he will do screen caps of like some Twitter, or excuse me, some Tinder profiles. And it'll usually be a woman who's got one kid or maybe two kids, and she's 30 years old, and she's smack dab in the middle of the epiphany phase. And it is so bloody predictable that, you know, he'll throw these out there, and it's funny, like for the first, you know, four or five of them. And then on number 6, 7, 8, 9, people, hey, Rollo, what do you think of this? The same thing I said about the other four or five that I saw before, like last week. That's how regular it is. That's how routine it is for, you know, women to want to look for that beta provider when they get to a point where they realize, or they have to sort of face the epiphany phase. And I've talked about the epiphany phase before, so I won't dig too much into that. But it's at the time of a woman's epiphany phase that you'll hear them complain and write articles about how men are not chivalrous anymore. They're not gentlemen anymore. If you are a gentleman, where are the real gentlemen? It's not so much the nice guy. I mean, they ask that too. Where are all the nice guys? They're back in your 20s where you left them. That's where the nice guys are. But it's not so much that. It's this complaint that guys aren't living up to what they believe should be their standards. And I thought about that, and I go, where do these standards come from? Like, how do you even come to believe in those standards? Because you're a woman of the 2000s, right? You're, well, you're 30 years old. You're born in what, 1990, right? So where did that come from? You know, you weren't born in the 50s. You weren't born prior to the sexual revolution. Why is that? How did you even come to believe that men should be gentlemen and chivalrous? How? Why is that something that still is a legacy, a vestige of that old school belief? Or old school, I guess, expectations, entitlements. Even when you look at women's entitlement, a lot of them are rooted in the foundations and the principles of old school chivalry. Men need to be the man of the house, you know, insofar as they're allowed to have authority. And of course, MGTOWs will throw this and you know, when I see conflicts between like MGTOWs and like TradCon guys, it's usually about like TradCon guys believe in marriage and they believe in family and loyalty and everything. Whether they're actually living that out is irrelevant, but that's the belief, right? That's that old school belief. It's the same old school belief that like women in their epiphany phase cling to when they need that guy, right? Now it's like, oh my God, I'm 30 years old. I can't party with these guys anymore. I can't get the hot ones anymore. I can't get the guys who are fun. And I need a man with some benefits. Well, those benefits are all rooted in old school chivalrous expectations. And it's not just opening doors. I open doors for old ladies. I'm a chivalrous knight. No, you're not. That's just common courtesy. Okay. And again, why is that common courtesy? Chivalry. But it is a standard by which we still cling to today, and it's something I think that's sort of been transferred over through popular culture. And I'll talk a little bit about that today. I've got a set of notes here that I'm going to get to, but let me. Okay, so here's the rules, guys. Once again, if you have a super chat or if you have a question, I still look at the. I try to look at the chat as best I can. I've got rugby and I have Sambadas in there as well. So I'll try to get to all of you. I can't give you too many guarantees because like things get past me, but I'm going to give you a little bit of extra time towards the end because I want to make sure I get to everybody. But yeah, if it's on topic, I will answer it straight away. But if it is off topic, I will wait till the end of the stream. And please, like, if it's something like, how do I get my girlfriend back? You're probably better off emailing me and give me, because you can't put that many characters. What do you get? 200 characters, something like that in a super chat. So, if it's something that's really involved, you can email me, you can get my attention on Twitter or whatever, and then I'll help you out that way. But if it's on topic, I will definitely check it out like this. Can you knock out my skipped super chat from last stream? It was TRP and family members and how to share red pill realizations if they need to. I will, Phil. I promise I'll get to you towards the end of today, okay? Sam, copy that one for me and hang on to that one for me, please. Let's see. Cute English accent. Bonnie Prince Charlie. Oh man. Okay. I don't want to do too many asides for this one, but, Bonnie Prince Harry has decided to sell his 50,000 pound rifle collection for shooting pheasants, of course. Is it okay to talk about Prince Harry yet? I don't know. Prince Harry is a travesty of a blue pill mindset. I keep coming back to Prince Harry because Prince Harry is the epitome of what's going on with what's been going on with blue pill men for a very long time. He is, if there's a definition, if you want a good like embodiment of what a blue pill mindset does to a beta male guy, particularly with a BPD girlfriend or wife, because I really think that she's borderline personality disorder. And we don't want to say anything different, but again, I think it's really kind of codependency. So if she says jump, he says how high, and he thinks that that's his masculine duty. And okay, watch me spin this one. So when he does something like that, he gave up hunting with his brother, right? He gave up, he decided to sell $50,000 in high quality hunting rifles. What are they like muzzle loaders? Is it like black powder weapons? I mean, who needs 50,000? Like after the first like two or three rifles, I mean, if that's your thing, okay. But $50,000, or 50,000. I don't know. What is 50,000 pounds? Probably more, actually. It's probably like more like $60,000, I think, in hunting. I guess maybe like there's going to be gun nuts or gun guys are going to go like, oh man, I could easily spend $60,000 on rifles. but the thing is why is he doing that? And what's the reaction to that? So when he decided he was not going to go hunting anymore with his brother, and he decided to sell off of his rifle collection. And when he decides to disown or turn down his royal, I don't know, appointment, his title, is he still the Prince of Sussex? Is he still the Duke of Sussex? I don't know if that's true anymore, because I know that he's sort of abdicated that and decided then he wanted to go to Canada. Well, she's not happy in Canada, so now we have to go to Los Angeles. So he feels that his duty to do all of this, he's got to be the guy who is, you know, doing what she wants, because that's what makes happy wife, happy life, right? That's a chivalric notion. Happy wife, happy life. If you can keep her happy, if you can qualify to her, if you are the guy that she selects over and over and over again, even in marriage, right? There's a difference between chivalry and marriage and the difference in chivalry and being single. I'm going to talk about that here in a little bit too. How does chivalry stand versus Royce's Skittles man? That is the exact polar opposite is what it is. When you make yourself your mental point of origin, when you don't make I'm trying to think of the most unchivalrous thing that I have written in any of my books. And I think it's this, is that a woman should only ever be a compliment to a man's life, never the focus of it. And that is the difference. That is the most unchivalrous thing Rollo Tomassi has ever written, because what it does is it takes the convention of chivalry and it turns us on its ass. That's what Royce was doing with the Skittles guy. He was just using that as an example. It's not like he made that guy. But it is putting your own needs ahead of hers and the feminine imperative. It is exactly what I've been saying for a very long time, is that it needs to be your frame and not her frame. Chivalry locks a man into a woman, into womankind's frame by default. So maybe that's a good place to start. Thank you. Yeah, you're right. Let me see what else we got going. Let's see. What did you say? I said, you talked about gammas, why men have more gamma tendencies. They think if they are white knights, they will have sex to have an alpha approach. Yeah. Okay. So, I always butcher your name, brother. Muhammad. I'm just going to call you Mr. Muhammad because I think that's your last name anyways. Yeah. Well, so why do we have white knights? In fact, the reason why we call them white knights is because that's a reference back to the idea of chivalry, right? It's I'm going to defend my lady's honor, and she's going to give me her favor so I can carry it into battle. And we still get guys that still love that old romanticism. And that's an important word to remember, romanticism, because chivalry is intimately tied to romanticism, or to the ideal of romantic love. And I'll explain to you how we get to that in just a second here. But let's see what else. So chivalry is an art. Too much chivalry, then many men get disrespected. Okay, why? Because we live in a time where women still have chivalrous entitlements and expectations, but they live on the fence. They still want to be independent. They still want to be their own person. They still want to expect men to play even Steven egalitarian equalism when it is convenient, and when it is time for them to feel security, they want the guy who is the noble knight, the knight in shining armor, to come and sweep them off their feet and to make all their problems go away. This is what Dalrock used to call his immutable law or something of feminism or something, in that women want independence and they want what I call fempowerment. They want to feel empowered. They want to have all of their problems solved for them. They hate men, but they want men to solve their problems for them. That's really the definition of feminism. That's Dalrock's definition of feminism. Royce has another one, of course, too, but Dalrock's, and I'm butchering this too, I'm sorry, Dalrock, if you already know this, you probably are going, what's he saying? But that women, actual feminists, hate men, but they necessarily need men to solve their problems for them. So that's like sort of like the feminist paradox, according to Dalrock anyways. If you believe that chivalry is an art, then you're locked into the chivalrous ideal already. When I say you need to unplug yourself from the matrix, when you need to kill the beta, when you need to take the red pill and essentially die to your old self, which was your beta blue pill self, the major part of that unplugging, of course, is making yourself your mental point of origin. When you make yourself your mental point of origin, you have to, by necessity, put off this chivalrous ideal. And it means that you become, well, first of all, your mental point of origin, yes, but it also means that you start to develop a framework into which you expect women to come into, rather than you having the expectation of moving into a woman's frame. And that's what most blue pill beta guys do, because they don't have any, most of them don't have the options not to do that. And I think that, in the last 20 years with the red pill and becoming more aware of intersexual dynamics, more and more guys are waking up. I don't think that's any secret, but what are they waking up to? People have asked me a million times, what is the blue pill? Why would the blue pill want to be, why would women want men to be trapped in, to be betas in waiting, right? Why would they want men to be trapped in this blue pill way of thinking, this blue pill conditioning? Why would they go to all this trouble? Well, first of all, it's a means of control. But this is why, what gets thrown at me all the time is they go, well, who's doing the controlling, man? It's got to be the Jews. It's got to be the Illuminati. It's got to be the socialists or the Marxists or whatever, like whatever your pet, outsider is, and that they throw that at me and they go, that's why feminism exists. No, feminism has existed way before that was even, long before. Like, the ideals of feminism are rooted in, well, technically Western European chivalry, what became of Western European chivalry. I shouldn't say, I don't want to make this just about Western European, history, okay? Because there's still, you'll find even in Eastern cultures, there's a form of chivalry in those cultures as well. Like in feudal Japan, they had the Bushido Code, okay? For Western Europe, in the, 1200, 1300, that was, chivalry. There was a chivalric code as well. I talk about that, of course, in the chapter in my book, but that's when, once I started digging into the history of chivalry and courtly love, which we're going to get to here in a second, it became more clear to me that it's not just this. I mean, maybe it was a useful tool for people throughout the ages, but that's not where it started. It started back, the ideal anyways of feminism and the feminine imperative was really born in courtly love. It was born at that time. And then that ended up becoming, I've called chivalry, or a bastardized form of chivalry, feminism 1.0, because it was used by the ladies and the women of the time as a form of control over men. Not unlike the way that we use feminism and gynocentrism as a control over men today. It became easier for women to do that during the sexual revolution. Once women had once men gave women the unilateral control of abortion, really abortion is what it is, but hormonal birth control. Once we said, okay, ladies, it's all on you. We've made this wonderful new pill. You just take it and you'll never get pregnant. And men were like, hot damn, finally. How long have we, since we jumped down out of the trees, men have been wanting to say, man, I'd love to have sex and not have to worry about pregnancy. And women too, hey, wouldn't it be great? Because now if I make a bad hypergamous choice, doesn't matter, because I got time to figure things out a little bit more and I could still enjoy myself and have sex with this guy. And now, after the sexual revolution, if I make a bad hypergamous decision and I happen to get pregnant, well, there's always abortion on demand now. It's one of the reasons why I keep saying that abortion is the ultimate expression of hypergamy. How do we get to that point? Well, we got to that point because we gave women that choice. We gave women the choice to have a child or not have a child. And that's a unilateral choice. Why is it that we think that it is a moral thing or it's the right thing to do to give women that choice? Now, not everybody does. I get that. But enough people did in Western cultures and even in like Latin cultures and some other cultures that are going on right now. I mean, I was looking at how we are celebrating in certain countries, how women are celebrating in certain countries, the right. It's no longer an option. It's a right to an abortion in like Ireland, which was probably the last Catholic holdout country, I think, that would have kept abortion out of that country. Then you got Argentina. You got some Latin cultures and stuff like that too. I forget the other one. Maybe it was Argentina. Some country in South America were celebrating it too, not too long ago. But why? Why do women fight tooth and nail for that? And then also, why is it that we think that, well, women know best? Why is it that we say, well, why is it that judges will award women custody of children in 87-89% of the time when it's a custody case? Why? What is it in the back of our heads that say, you know what, a woman is would make a better single parent than a single dad? And whether the guy wants it or not, right? I mean, but like, let's just say they equally want it. The one who, they can split custody, I get that, but who gets a primary custody? Who do we think makes a better, if there's only going to be one parent of a child, who makes a better parent? The man or the woman? Well, Western society has said the woman in every case for a very long time because she's the mother, she knows best. Why do we think that? Why do we believe that she would make a better parent for her? Well, they're the nurturers. Oh, men will just, what was it, like the Homer Simpson, the Homer Simpson gambit. If you leave a newborn baby with Homer Simpson, he'll trade it for a six pack in the nudie magazine. that's what we think guys will do. Why? Why do we have to make them idiots? Why do we confuse men about masculinity? No, I'll tell you here. On YOLO. Hi, can a woman fall in love or love a chivalrous beta man with only beta bucks after her epiphany phase? If so, is it the same love for the alpha? Okay, well, we need to separate a few things here because I'll answer that. That will come in due course, YOLO. Trust me. Let's see. Is chivalry a form of male sacrifice? That is an article of it. That is an article of chivalry. To lay down your life for my lady's honor, right? Let's see. Okay, I think I caught up. Good. All right, guys. So let's now we're going to get to the history lesson part of chivalry. As soon as I have my bulletproof coffee. Still not sponsored. Okay. So we have to go back in time. Now, I'm going to talk about chivalry and romantic love and courtly love, also known as fine love, and how things sort of panned out for us since this time. Now, this is not just a Western white European concept, okay? This is also, there's an Islamic part of this as well. In fact, was it the Moors, like the ancient, well, the old school Islam had a lot of writings on like the definition of what love should be. And a lot of what we draw, I think, from the idea of romantic love, some of that actually comes from Islam. Some of that comes from noble women of the time as well. You can also find parallels to this in China. You can find parallels to this in Japan, feudal Japan for sure. And other, you know, you could sort of just see it on the periphery, I guess. So I'm going to talk about the chivalry in the classical sense here. Okay. So don't think that this is just about, you know, well, it's just about you guys, you know, it's just about your culture. And no, it's not. Okay. This is like something that is, put it this way, chivalry would not be such a big deal if it wasn't something that like we, like most human beings were sensitive to in the first place. And I'll tell you why that is here in a second. But so we go back in time. Okay. Let's go back to the Middle Ages, the Dark Ages, right? And back in the Dark Ages, we have the Holy Roman Empire. We've got these city states. We've got these moneyed landowners. Okay. Where you've got, it wasn't even so much knights at that time. It was just, but it was like guys just beating the shit out of each other. Okay. It was brigandism. That's why they called it the Dark Ages. It was a rough time. Okay. I mean, we're killing, smacking each other with, you know, maces and shit. So you have these sort of city states. We have these moneyed landowners who have like kind of their own private militias. And then you've got the Holy Roman Empire, which is trying to unite all of this stuff, and they need resources. So how do you lock these guys into your cause? Well, at some point along the way, real true chivalry has nothing to do with women. It has nothing to do with romance. It has nothing to do with a milady's honor. Chivalry was actually a code that was to be upheld amongst higher born men. Okay, it wasn't for the commoners so much. It was for the guys who were actually allowed to own swords and own armor and horses and be able to protect, you know, particular lands and stuff like that. And again, I'm not a historian, so you know, you can tell me I suck at my history here after all of this, but it's kind of irrelevant to the point I'm making. But so anyways, you've got this code of chivalry that is sort of something that it appealed to the martial values, let's say, of the guys at the time. So if you could kick ass, there was sort of this expectation at that time where you don't hit the weak, right? You don't hit somebody who's unarmed, particularly even if it's an opponent, even if it's an enemy, if they drop their swords, like, you get your sword. So you can have that sort of fair fight kind of thing. And so rather than just this random, you know, beating the hell out of each other, we had some sort of rules that went along to it. I think when people see like old school movies, like if you look at like Napoleonic era wars, where you, or even like, American colonial or the War for Independence, right? All the way up to the Civil War, you've got lines of guys who are lining up to shoot their guns. But they're not, it's not guerrilla warfare, right? They're not skirmishers. They're doing everything by the book. This is what we do. This is how we go in. We all, like the first rank fire, second rank fire, you know, that kind of stuff. Like, and people look at this and they go, what, are they insane? Why aren't they looking for cover? Why aren't they, you know, like, it's not like World War I or World War II or Vietnam. It's not like those conflicts. Because, you know, all bets were off. We're not going to sit out there in our, you know, we're not going to, oh, the redcoats are coming. You know, we're not going to be out there in our uniforms and everything. We look at this and we think, these guys were insane. They put themselves in front of, like, you know, live ammunition and they didn't move. And that was part of, like, just the rules of engagement at that time. Now, I'm not saying that that's necessarily chivalry, but in a way it was. It was certainly an extension of chivalry at that time. Like, this is how we do it. And then, you know, if you break and run, then you're cowards and you don't stay there and stand and take a bullet in the chest. And so that's that real chivalry is among men. And it was started amongst men, but it was also started as a means of control by the Roman Catholic Church at that time. Now, this is chivalry. Okay. I'm not talking about anything else in the world. So you have this sort of masculine duty or these masculine responsibilities of chivalry. Now, of course, the commoners picked up on this as well. They wanted to be, you know, they wanted to live up to the expectations of people who are their betters, right? They want, oh, that this is the way the knights do it, so this is the way we're going to do it. So things kind of trickle down a little bit. So you've got chivalry as the code of chivalry anyways was a set of martial rules amongst men. And that was intended by, it was codified, I should say, into the Roman Catholic Church at that time. And so therefore, after that, it became something that was a little bit more religious. So it's now serve the church, serve your God, so it's gone from an agreement, a gentleman's agreement amongst men, your duty, your masculine honor and everything, to being honoring God, honoring the church leadership, honoring the Pope, honoring whatever, and doing what they tell you to, because now they are puts them sort of in the control using chivalry. So chivalry as a code of honor between men became very useful to the church at the time. Well, now we need to advance things a little bit more. So we move up into, like, say, the 1400s, somewhere around there. And you have noble women who now are looking at chivalry and turn chivalry into what we consider chivalry today. And that's why I keep coming back to this and saying, you know, chivalry is a bastardized form of chivalry today. Well, what we call chivalry is not really chivalry today. So like when guys say, well, chivalry's dead and women killed it, or, you know, I open doors for old ladies, or I, you know, pick up the handkerchief from a lady kind of thing. Like, nobody's doing that. That's not what women mean. Women mean control now. So, and they meant control back then as well. So now we got to flash forward. And, I can name some names of Marie Aquitaine and some of these other ones that really, you know, these are noble women of the court at the time who were married into kind of like stagnant marriages, because back then marriage wasn't necessarily about what we think of marriages today. And women, you know, feminists will say this all the time, you know, well, women were just married because they were cattle to women or to men, and they were just pieces of property. And well, yes and no. Noble women were, because usually marriages of higher born people, noble people, were meant to solidify alliances. There's a lot of politics that went on as a result of marriage. Lower born, the great seething masses of the peasants and everything, they weren't, the women weren't, they were, I mean, technically, I guess they were, but they were, it's not the same thing. When we think about, like, oh, well, women couldn't own property. Well, when you're a peasant, you don't have any, but you really don't have much property. Okay. So, it's kind of a facetious argument to go and say that, you know, well, women were pushed around, and they were. I mean, they were used as political tools back then. But marriage was really amongst the nobility, amongst the people who were making decisions for other people. It was a form of, well, political control, but like marriage was just a formality. So if you have a nobleman, or you've got people, even the royalty, well, you know, mid to upper royalty, you know, unless you were like the very highest of the high, as a man, you probably got your sexual needs met through either a mistress or the spoils of war, whoever you were raping while you were on campaign. And then you would come back, and then you had a wife, but it's not like you were, and the only reason, even if you had a wife, really the only reason to have a wife is so that she can bear you a son, and therefore that son becomes the next prince or the next nobleman, and then that solidifies the alliance. And of course, they had to have the son, of course. And there's a lot of stories. I mean, we can go and dig through. I mean, you guys have seen these movies before. If you go and you look at like Robert the Bruce and those things. Yeah, I need a son. Or even, what is it? Was it Anne Boleyn, right? That's why, what was it, King Henry? It was King Henry. Yeah, King Henry, you know, wanted, that's why he decided to split from the Catholic Church, because he couldn't get a divorce. He wanted to nail somebody else who was going to give him a son. That was something that was important to the guy, okay? So anyways, you're in this, and I know, again, I'm butchering this because I'm going from like all the way from like the 1400s all the way up to like probably a 1600s or, well, late 1500s. But during this time, this is when women are, you know, the wives and the noble women of the time are interested in what ends up becoming courtly love. And courtly love was an idea that was developed at the time. It was really from playing games in court, really. Like, what, it was these discussions, these long discussions about, like, what is love and how does love do this? And it was about romance, like the highest forms of love, or the high, you know, what is true love? Like, we still talk about that today. True love. What is true love? What is romantic love? And really, the ideas of romantic love and courtly love were spawned at that time in the, that's why they call it courtly love, right? So there was like, there were discussions. I mean, these are real discussions, but like, what happens is you have these higher born women who start talking about romantic ideals and then attaching those ideals to chivalry. So in the same way that the church started using chivalry to advance its own interests, women started to use chivalry to advance their own interests. So it was no longer serve your church, serve this. Well, now we have to attach, you know, you must bow before women. You must do what women say. You must earn and qualify milady's favor, right? You must do all of these things, because, or you would get... was it, like even the knights at the time, they would have to find some woman for whom to fight for, because that ended up becoming their means of, you know, a virtue of qualifying themselves, of being, I guess, amplifying their status, right? And so what happens is you see women moving the ideals of courtly love into the codes of chivalry. So if men have to do these things, if it is your masculine duty to follow this code of chivalry, let's insert some things in there that are going to benefit women. And this is where you get the very beginnings of the feminine imperative. So all of the things that would benefit women, and you have to kind of dig yourself into what courtly love was really all about. Because back then, courtly love was kind of like women's way of getting around the marriage side of things, because they knew that they were married to a guy that they weren't really all that attracted to and they didn't want to be with, but they still wanted to sort of feel that indignation and still feel alive and still feel that chemical rush. So as a result of that, we come up with these ideals that we still hold today. So when we talk about like romanticism, like when Oprah says you got to keep it fresh, when Oprah says you got to do date night, when Christian pastors say, well, you know, you got to do what she says, happy wife, happy life. That is a direct descendant of that courtly love ideal. Doing what she says to make her happy, opening the doors. That's what really the idea of a bastardized chivalry came from. So if it becomes your masculine duty to open the doors for or pay for a date, right? Or to be this masculine, chivalrous ideal, I guess. So when we talk about chivalry, we're not really talking about chivalry anymore. We're talking about chivalry that has been assimilated by courtly love. Now, if you look at how the ideal, let's rewind just a little bit. The ideals of courtly love, and they ended up becoming what I call the romantic ideal. So, and actually I didn't even come up with that. It's really just the natural progression here. The romantic ideal is that the only real love is romantic love. And if you're married, you can't be, remember how, was it MGTOWs MGTOWs, like everybody say, well, if you're married, like if people throw this at me all the time, well, don't listen to Rollo because he's married, right? You can't be an alpha and be married. You can't be a red pill and be married. Like marriage is fundamentally blue pill. That's what you'll hear guys say. And the reason they say that is really because from back in the day, real true love between people required jealousy. And I've said this before as well, and I picked this up from Mystery, because Mystery says the only way that a woman can get infatuated with you, or the only way that a woman really loves you, is to feel jealousy for you. And that is a direct descendant from the romantic ideal of courtly love. Courtly love was clandestine. It was secret. I'm sure if you've read any of the literature, especially in Shakespeare and Shakespearean plays, it was always a secret love. We can't tell our parents because they'll separate us. We need to elope. That's the idea of eloping, was we were keeping our romance a secret. So we're going to elope, have a priest marry us, and then we'll come back married and we'll legitimize our love. Now I dug into this because again, I'm writing book four about religion, and the Dalrock has written so much about how chivalry has sort of been bastardized, I should say, by romantic ideals, but has also bastardized the church itself, and not just the Roman Catholic Church, but all churches, and not even just from a religious sense, but also from a romantic ideal sense. So even secular society, even atheists, like if you read my first book, if you read in the beginning of my first book, I have the There Is No One. And I outline an incident where I was in university one time, and I had a teacher asked, she said, how many of you believe in God? And people would raise their hand. Most of them didn't. And then how many of you are atheists? Blah, blah, blah. Then she said, how many of you believe that there is you have a soulmate out there, or that you've met your soulmate? And every friggin' hand shot up. Every single one. So you've got like, I don't see the romance, like if you think about soulmates and you think about one-itis, or the basis of one-itis anyways, it really comes from that romantic ideal that the only real love is like this romantic love. It's this true love. It's this kind of like love that you would die for. This love that is, like, I think when I say guys are idealistic about love, it comes from an innate idealism in men, but that is something that is easily preyed upon by the ideal of romantic love. I'll never meet anybody who's perfect for me. I want a woman who will love me as much as I love her. And you think about those things and you see just how easy it is to manipulate guys. So when you see guys who are saying, well, you know, you're pussy whipped. Yeah, that's where that comes from. You're pussy whipped because your head space is in qualifying to women. And that's one of the things that I think the black pill and MGTOW and the red pill, myself, a lot of other people will say, you know, it's a game of qualification. Even old school pickup artists used to say the same thing, is that you need to get the woman to qualify to you, not you qualify to her, because that qualifying to her puts you in her frame. So the woman who's sitting at the bar and having guys going, hey, you're so pretty, can I buy you a drink? Like that guy's like just straight from his very first words out of his mouth is qualifying and presuming a frame that she's in control of, rather than like, you know, that's why guys thought that, you know, a neg hit was so offensive. Well, it's offensive for two reasons. First of all, it gets women to qualify to you, or that's the intent of it. And it flips the romantic ideal on its head, which is, why don't you buy me a drink? Why don't, you know, whatever you want to talk about. But the thing is that the one of the reasons why PUA, the red pill, whatever you want to call it, is so offensive to most people is because it offends that romantic ideal. That's what we've been taught for, you know, for centuries now, that it is our masculine duty to do what women want us to do. If we don't, then we're not going to be worthy of her affection. We're not going to be worthy of her sexual attention. And that's where we get beta males and we get blue pill guys, because they are in a constant state of qualifying themselves. Now, people won't go, well, why would anybody do that? Like, especially when you're outside, when you're removed from everything, when you're red pill and you look at the guys like, well, you look at Prince Harry, what is he doing, right? Prince Harry just sold $50,000 worth of rifles because Meghan doesn't like him. She doesn't like hunting. Well, what Meghan wants, Meghan gets. Well, you can put it that way, but you can also look at it this way. Why would a man want to sacrifice? And this goes back to your question, by the way. Why would a man want to sacrifice things for a woman? Like guys will say, like, you know, when I got married, I had to sell off my Lego collection. Remember that story? I want them. These aren't important to him. They shouldn't be important to him. I'm going to get rid of them and throw them away, right? Well, of course, the guy ended up throwing her out. And that makes him seem as if it is a, like here, okay, so here we go. Okay, hold on a second, Billy Jeff. Red pill is a cult. Now I'm going to ask you why. Why do you think that red pill is a cult? The reason that you think red pill is a cult is because what we reveal in the red pill, what we talk about, what we discuss is offensive to that romantic ideal, right? So if you don't do those things, a lot of guys get locked into this thing. They think that if I don't do what women want me to do, then I'm not going to be desirable. It's m'lady's, you know, decision. We even talk about that. Have you heard of this? I'm sure you guys have heard this maxim as well. It's called the, a woman's prerogative. A woman has the right to change her mind. Why? The guy doesn't have a chance. The guy has to say what he means. It means what he says. Why do we put up with that? Why do we think, she wanted to before, now she doesn't. Why is it that we can look at something like Me Too and say, well, there shouldn't be statutes of limitations on sexual harassment? Why? You know, from a practical, pragmatic sense, guys go, well, you know, if it happened 30 years ago and she hasn't said anything about it, then the reason why we think that that is logical and we don't put statutes of limitations on those things is because of the romantic ideal. Because we think that whatever a woman wants or whatever she's saying is like believe all women, even believe all the hashtag believe all women still finds its root in the romantic ideal, because we got to believe what she says. We got to do what she says. And yeah, was there times, you know, for a very long time, right up really until the sexual revolution. Yeah. Progressively, you know, women were, you know, politically and decision wise were more powerless. particularly the women of the period that I was just talking about during the time of courtly love. Women didn't have, they couldn't do much of anything. But women have always used power covertly, the same way that they are, the same way they communicate, the same way that they emote. It's all about, it's kind of like that emotive side of things. Remember what I said before, how it's for women, it's instinct, emotion, and reason. For men, it's instinct, reason, and then emotion. So you take those dynamics and you look at how women will turn those dynamics into what they believe should be the standard, right? When I talk about feminine correctness, when I say how, like, we right now, at least in a post-sexual market or in a post-sexual revolution society, we want, well, first of all, we still prioritize whatever, you know, whatever benefits the feminine imperative. But why do we do that? Why do we keep coming back to that? Why is there even an old social contract? So let's see here. I'm getting distracted. Sorry, guys. I probably should read the Code of Chivalry to you, but the romantic ideal pretty much coincides with a lot of what I have talked about when it comes to hypergamy, when it comes to men and women's innate sexual market, or excuse me, innate mating strategies, sexual strategies. And so when we look at what women use that power for, it is almost universally used for their own security. So if you look at the ideals of romantic love, like I said, it's secret. It, like, the very nature of it is secret. It's clandestine. It's also based on infidelity as well, at least the emotional side of it. It's true courtly romantic love, what they used to call fine love, wasn't so much about the sex part, although that was part of it, but it wasn't focused on oh boy, I can't wait to get with this guy, although I'm sure some of them did. But it was more about the feelings. It was more about tapping into that indignation and tapping into that emotional side of things. So you get this in literature, right? Forbidden love. Forbidden love is another aspect of romantic love. It's not real, true, fine love unless it's forbidden, unless there's something, there's some sort of chance that you're going to get found out. And the only, and women will do this today too, it's secret except for, like, your confidants or the people who arrange your meetings for you. Like, if you look in the writings of Shakespeare and his romantic plays, like Romeo and Juliet and things like that, it's the romance, the courtly romance is being, you know, the illicit romance is being arranged by friends, like, oh, we got to get these two together kind of thing. Shh, don't say anything. You know, you're sworn to secrecy because it's all for true love. And I think about how many stories revolve around the idea of true love. What makes true love? So I wanted to throw that in there, but here's the other part, and this is the part I get to in my book, is that not only does chivalry get sort of perverted and distorted to serve the feminine imperative, but it also finds its way into religion, and also particularly Christianity, but others as well. Like, you can still find traces of this, or you can still find links to this in other religions. So it's not just, if you go and you look at certain, if you look at, like, what is it, Kama Sutra, and I can't remember the name of the guy who was the, was a Hindu guy, but it was a Buddhist guy. But talking about, like, the proper, you know, relations between men and women, or the true natures of men and women. You'll see these writings throughout, you know, you'll see parallels of it throughout other cultures and all around the world. So what happens then is we go from a chivalry, which is really a duty now, to uphold milady's honor, milady's virtue, to do what she says, to, like, the highest thing a guy, a knight, right, can achieve is the favor of his lady, right? And we still see that today. We still see that reflected in, particularly in Christianity, but also we see that in just, like, secular culture as well. We want to make her happy. guys will make it their life's mission, right? That's why I keep saying, you know, you need to make your life, or you need to make, you know, women should be a compliment to your life, not the focus of it. Why is that radical? Why does that make the red pill cult to say something like that? Because it goes against that narrative. And that narrative has been with us for a very long time. And it's infiltrated. Like I've said this before. I've said that feminism, particularly now, has infiltrated mainstream religions. That's really the premise of book four. At least the last, I would say, third of the book is about that. It's how feminism and how the feminine imperative has assimilated our religious ideas, and just basically how dangerous that is. But this is not the first time this has happened. This is just round two, like what we're going through right now. Like when I go and I look at like Nadia Bowles, I think that's what her name is, Presbyterian pastoress, right? Priestess, Lutheran priestess, you know, tatted up, looks like, and she is probably the stereotypical look of a butch lesbian. When you look at that, when you look at women getting into ministry, when you look at just how the feminine imperative, gynocentrism, has modified and assimilated so many male spaces, and you go, wow, how is this happening? Why are we letting this happen as men? Well, we're doing it because we're still trying to please not just our women, but womankind in general. So, again, let's rewind back again to Courtly Love. What happens there is the articles of Courtly Love, romantic, the ideal of romantic love, starts to work its way into the Bible, into religion in general. And so now we see that rather than a biblical kind of marriage, we see a romantic based marriage. And this is, the reason I'm hesitating here is because I'm trying to remember what Dale Rock had said. He said that romantic love is now the framework in which marriage, romantic love verifies or justifies a marriage rather than marriage justifying romantic love. So what happens is romantic love becomes a framework in which it's okay to be married, right? Rather than being married is the place where you're going to have romantic love or romantic sex or whatever. And I don't think people really understand that. They don't realize, particularly in a religious sense, they don't understand that. Because you'll see guys who are still trying to play up to that. I mean, beta male guys, the guys we would stereotypically say are beta males or blue pill condition guys, are always about qualifying. It's always his qualifications. Well, that qualification is still this, because they've been conditioned to be that romantic ideal, that if they don't do what they're supposed to do, then they will displease their wives. They'll displease the women in their, they'll displease mommy. They'll displease their female teachers. Now, if we add religion to that, not only are you, if you displease a woman, you're displeasing God. So the romantic ideal becomes God's ideal. So when you are not, you know, happy wife, happy life, if she's not happy, if she's unhappy, that's always your fault. It's always a guy's fault for her unhappiness, because if she's not happy, then God's not happy. Because that now, through the ages, since the time of courtly love, we've pretty much, and it's funny, if you read the book, I won't give too much of the book away, actually, but during the time of the Puritans actually incorporated romantic love into puritanical Christian marriage. So when somebody says, like when a couple who has been together for a while, like a boyfriend, girlfriend, they're living together, they're having sex together, when they finally decide to get married, what do they say? Well, we're finally going to make our love official. So what that, and this, again, I'm quoting Dale Rock here, but what that means is that for women there, and this goes with what I've talked about in my book, Preventive Medicine, is that from the time a woman, say like 18, until she gets to be up into her epiphany phase, that is time that she is, quote unquote, discovering herself, right? It's her journey of self-discovery. And usually that means it's the cock carousel. Usually that means she's having a string of either one-hit relationships, or she's having sex with guys. Oh, he's not the right one. That's why we get the idea of the one. or the soulmate. Well, he wasn't the one. He wasn't the soulmate. He wasn't the guy that I was supposed to. I was predestined. It wasn't true love. It was, we didn't fall in love, or we were in love, but you know, it was complicated, right? Those kinds of things. Well, what happens is when that woman finally gets to what ideally what's supposed to happen is that woman goes through, a series of lovers, a series of ups and downs, coming together, getting that high, and then breaking up and feeling bad, and then getting together and feeling that high, and then breaking up again. That's technically that's how whether we really do that anymore, I don't know, particularly in the age of Tinder, but that's the idea. The romantic idea of this particular age is, well, women need to discover themselves and they need to discover what's right for them and who the right guy is. And, sooner or later, the one will come along. And if you want to talk about this in a religious sense, then we can say, well, I just was waiting for the man that God had preordained for me. And so what happens is the romantic ideal becomes God's ideal, or it becomes the ideal in which you can get married, or you can, okay, I finally met my soulmate. It's all okay. Now I'm going to get married. And that's where you get the letdown, because it's no longer up and down and up and down. And I tell guys this too. I said, I've said this a million times, you probably will remember this, is I said, you need to be her drug dealer. When I talked about indignation, I said that as well. Part of that indignation is feeling jealousy, or feeling dread. When I say you need to insert some kind of dread, even if it's just passive dread, there needs to be some kind of imagination. That's what women, even if you've been married to your wife for 10 years, you want to know how to keep it fresh. It's not date night. It's stoking that imagination, because what happened prior is she had these highs and lows and highs and lows. So, and if you're not giving that to her, she's going to get it vicariously through her girlfriends. She's going to get it through daytime television, the Tyra Banks show. She's going to get it through The Bachelorette. You know, she's going to get it some way. Like I said, if in the absence of indignation, women will create it for themselves. Well, why? Because a romantic ideal is actually part of women's mating strategy. So if you think that a lot of this qualification, like where women select and men display, women select, eggs are expensive, sperm is cheap. Men are disposable, women are valuable. That's why romantic love and chivalry, bastardized chivalry, is so effective, and it's still here today. So when people say, well, chivalry is dead. No, it's not dead. It's still here. You just don't realize that you are still a part of that. Did you go watch Titanic? Oh, yeah, it was a great movie. Well, that's the romantic ideal that has been set by a chivalry that is as old as the noble courts of Western Europe back in the Middle Ages. At least that, you could probably go back further, I think, but that's where I'm going. That's where the word came up with, came from. Now, so here's the next thing I want to throw out there at you guys. So let's see. Want to make sure I'm covering everything that I've got right here. So what is the future for a romanticized love? Why do we even care about this right now? Well, we care about it because it's something that's been going on in the background in a rapidly globalizing Western culture for a very long time. So now it's not just here in the United States or in Europe or even in Latin countries, it's all over the world. And guys will say, well, not in my country, not in my religion, not in my, well, not yet. It will get there. Like when I talk to guys about, guys will say, well, I'm going to go to Southeast Asia, or I'm going to go to Poland because it's easier to get laid there. Like that's what Roosh did, right? Roosh decided that he thought Poland was pussy paradise. He wrote a book about it, Pussy Paradise. He left Poland for like 2 or 3 years. He comes back and Poland is no longer pussy paradise, as the women there have cell phones, they have smartphones, they're part of the global community now, and maybe they weren't before. And so you've got women in China, you got women in Philippines, you got women in Southeast Asia, they all have cell phones. They're all part of this globalizing sort of pop culture that is defined by Western romanticism. Well, like when black pill guys complain about like, oh, I'm not tall enough, I'll never get laid. They don't like Asian men, or they don't like Indian men, blah, blah, blah. I'm not tall enough. Help, help, help. Well, that's part of the global sexual marketplace that's going on right now. Because they say, well, it doesn't matter if you go to the Philippines. Like guys would say, well, you go to the Philippines, you can get laid like tile. Well, yeah, that maybe still, but the problem is if you can't get laid in the United States, you probably can't get laid in the Philippines or Southeast Asia. And say, well, all you gotta do is have a lot of money. Well, you can get, if you have a lot of money, you can get laid in the United States. Why would you, you know, there's guys paying what, $39.99 for a bottle of pee right now. So, you know, money is money. Okay. So if you're talking about like, oh, I'm going to find me a nice feminine wife in, you know, Guam, you know, where do you go? You know, Peru, and then bring her back. And then of course you get the Eddie Murphy joke. Well, you bring her back and then she turns into a feminist. Well, guess what? She's already a feminist when you get there now, because westernized feminism, which is based primarily on old school romantic ideals that were intended to be what we now call the gynocentrism. And now really gynocentrism that MRAs talk about, that MGTOW would talk about, that everybody talks about, all that stuff, all of that was instigated and was brought into this century through romantic love and the qualifications that men are supposed to have as a part of that chivalrous ideal, that chivalrous notion that we should all be, you know, live our lives to be good men. And the way to be good men is to make women happy. And that's really a chivalrous ideal. So let me, finally, and then my last point here, I've got one last little bullet point, and then I'm going to give you guys some time to ask me questions because we are at 1:11 right now. Okay, I promised. So where do we go from here is the next question. And this is a question that I answer towards the end of this book. And Sam Botta, I know you're listening right now. You and I have talked about this before, where I've talked about how we're sort of leaning towards a one world religion. And it is my belief that that one world religion will be brought in by women and brought in by gynocentrism. That's why this is important. Because once we got globalization and we got rapid globalization, because of the internet from like, say, let's just round off at 2000, at year 2000. Since year 2000, we had all of this interconnectivity. We spread ideas, and one that's been spread through popular media, through the internet, through movies, through songs forever has been the romantic ideal. Remember how I said that if you go back and you listen, or you go, like we were saying before, you go back and you watch Mrs. Doubtfire, or you watch the movie Blue Valentine, or you watch Forrest Gump with the red pill lens. You watch those things and you think, oh my God, this is a horror movie. Because now you're aware. You're watching this from red pill aware to year 2020 awareness of all of the dynamics that were going on in that story. And you can't watch it anymore. Or you don't watch it in the same way. It was the same thing with Mrs. Doubtfire. Mrs. Doubtfire is horrifying now. Or you look at like the songs that you used to enjoy. We joked about that before. You say, you know, let's list all the songs that we think are really blue pill, right? Ha ha. Well, the reason they are is because all of those are rooted in a romantic ideal that is meant to, sing sonnets of true love to your lady and to forgive her of all her indiscretions. So what does that do to a culture? Well, to a globalizing culture, but what does that do to like Western humanist culture? I'm not talking even about religion at this point. I'm talking about secular culture. What does that do to that secular culture? Well, it places women at the top of that heap. It's whatever, like I've said this before, is that we train our boys like they're defective girls, but we also train them to presume what I call female correctness, feminine correctness. Whatever works for women, whatever works for the benefit of the feminine imperative is the correct way to interpret something. So if I say, well, when we talk about like how guys need to be, you need to get in touch with your emotional side. You need to express yourself emotionally more. Or you're not emotionally available. There's something wrong with you. Like if a guy, and men and women, like biologically, we don't process emotion in the same way. But because of that, men are like retarded and stunted and I mean that in the clinical sense. I mean, they don't emote right, or they don't think right because they're not thinking like women. That's why we say get in touch with your feminine side, because that would be the correct way to do it. Why do we think that's the correct way? Because that's the romantic ideal. whatever serves the feminine imperative, whatever serves the feminine is the correct way to not just behave, but also to think about behaving. So that we'll get into, I want to answer Yolo's question because it's pertinent to this here too, is when we talk about guys in terms of like alpha and beta, like the dynamics don't change with respect to like hypergamy. So you still got women are, they want to have, you know, alpha seed, beta need. They still want to have sex with the alpha guy, but they still want the provisioning and everything from the beta guy. We've changed things a little bit, but the beta guy, the blue pill guy, the guy that we want to be serviceable, and I've said that before, the guy that we want to be serviceable, that guy has to follow the romantic ideal. But the alpha guy, the guy that they want, the sexy fireman and the fireman cow, the guy in the, here we go again. I got to say this every show. The guy who is the hot guy in the foam cannon party in spring break in Cancun. He was cute. She was drunk and one thing led to another. That guy doesn't have to play by those rules. She doesn't make rules, right? We've said this before. Women break rules for alphas and they make rules for betas. Okay, what rules? What are those rules? Those rules are set by chivalry. They're set by a chivalry that was bastardized by romantic, courtly, fine love way back in 1200 AD, 1300 AD, somewhere around there. Again, I'm not a historian. So those are the rules, right? Well, you're supposed to do those things. You're not a real man unless you do X. We hear that all the time. A real man steps up and a real man dates single mothers. A real man would take a woman, wouldn't care if your woman cheats. That right there. Like I see that. Sorry, ladies, but I see black women do that all the time. Like they say, well, if a woman cheats, that man should be able to forgive her and move on. He needs to be secure in his masculinity. That's the funny thing is like security in your masculinity is how well you align yourself with the chivalric romantic ideal. If you were a man, you would be doing these things. And women hold that over them. Women today, and I would like to say a lot of the guys, particularly more religious tradcon guys, do the same thing is they like to hold the manhood card over guys. Well, a real man does this. A real man gets up at 4 a.m. and does, you know, naked push-ups and then takes a cold shower. That's what a real man does. And if you don't, you're not a real man. Well, what does a real man do for women? Well, a real man marries a single mother and takes care of her kids for her. He's not the stepdad. He's the dad who stepped up. Here's the man card. You're a man now. Right? And so, but again, why? Why do we get there? What is it that makes why is it that what serves women it should be the masculine ideal? We talk about duty and we talk about honor, and I do believe that those are intrinsic things that men hold, but they're modified. They're modified by social conventions, and those social conventions find their root in chivalry and the romantic ideal. And that romantic ideal is a means of control by the feminine imperative, and has been so for a long time. So going forward, what's happened here is that in this new frontier, in this new internet world, in this new global community that we are entering into, women and really kind of the imperative, it's sort of like this natural kind of push towards these things, because we want to, if the feminine imperative is one thing, it can fluidly change as times and environment change. And again, this isn't some like fiendish plot kind of thing. It is just women's need for control and men's need for control as well. That's always vying with the other. That didn't change until the sexual revolution. And guess what? With the globalizing internet age right now, that's also a period or an upheaval, I guess, in society that the, when we look at like, say, things like the invention of atomic weapons, we look at, and I've rated this as on par with that, which is hormonal birth control for women is an invention that has upset, you know, global humanity. And what, I mean, you could say, well, for the better or the worse, okay, but it is something that has changed the course of human history. Internet is another one of those changes. And with every one of those changes, and I'm just using, you know, those as examples here, but at every one of those changes, you will see the imperatives of men and women shift. And so right now we're trying to say, well, that this is why women get pissed off at guys, because they're not like living, they're not living up to the masculine, the chivalric ideal. What happened to all the gentlemen? You didn't care about them when you're in party years, because those are the times that you're trying to maximize your peak sexual market value years. Only later, when you've discovered yourself, that's when you need the guy who will follow the chivalric ideal, the romanticized chivalric ideal. And so that's how you get white knights. White knights, you now mix that in with guys who are blue pill white knight or blue pill alphas. They become the worst white knights, because they're the ones who will, you know, I think blue pill white knights that got, or excuse me, alpha blue pill white knights, those guys are the most frustrating men in the world for women, because they're hot and they want to get with them, but they still are sucking on the teat of blue pill romanticism. And they want them to be the bad boy. They want them to do that. And they look like they'd be a lot of fun if they would just like sort of just throw all this, you know, pretense of morality out the window so that they could get with them, because that's what's hot for women. But they're still, you know, I'll do anything for you, baby, you know, or you got a flat tire? No problem. It's like, we call it Captain Save-A-Ho, right? And so that all, again, even Captain Save-A-Ho comes from the romantic ideal. If I do, it's the transactional nature of relationships. That's why I keep saying transactional nature, the transactional and validational sex. Validational sex is the clandestine, I'm going to cheat on him, he's so hot, I got to get with him right now, I'm going to follow alpha seed side of hypergamy. That's a validational side. The transactional side is I want a guy who I can control with rules. And those rules, the chivalric ideal says you got to do these things. Men aren't living up to their potential. Men aren't preparing. I hear this all the time from like the moralistic tradcon set. Men are not living up to their, you know, they're not, what is it? They're perpetuating their adolescence, right? Like you will hear tradcon guys, particularly the pastors who have tried to insert themselves into red pill communities. They'll say, well, you know, we need to start a red pill ministry because we need to get these guys on the right track. Okay, what's the right track? Oh, we need them to prepare themselves to be good husbands and to be good fathers and to have and to basically cater their lives so that when the time is right, when m'lady decides that she needs a beta, or she needs a blue pill guy, blue pill beta more than she needs the fun alpha, you'll be right there. We need to get these guys set up in the right place at the right time so that they can pass all those tests, so that they can meet the romantic chivalric code at the right time, which means and guys will use that. They'll use that as their game, particularly blue pill guys. Blue pill guys love to use that. Oh, I would be the perfect boyfriend for you. How come she keeps going and banging this guy? He doesn't love her. I love her. How can she can't see that? Well, she can't see that from the ages of 18 until she's about 28. 29, you're the holy shit. I can't believe it's you. You've been here all the time and I've loved you. And you're perfect for me. And I just didn't realize it at the time. Now that I've matured and grown and I've ended my journey of self-discovery, I've realized you're the right guy. Oh, good, honey. And the guys who have pretty much lived their lives according to the chivalric ideal, I got to go and make sure I'm a upstanding member of community, and I'm going to be pro-social about everything, and I'm going to have a good job. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. I'm just saying that the impetus and the reason for you doing that, well, remember, we talk about crisis of motive. Why do you do that? Well, you do that because you believe in this chivalric ideal. And you're ready to turn the other way and or to forgive indiscretions and not worry about whether or not she's got, you know, three kids from two different fathers. Because if you're a real man, you would just step up and do that. Why? Well, that's what real men do. That's the romantic ideal. Okay, sounds good. I'm the man who stepped up. All right, so going forward, I think that what's happening right now with respect to the romantic ideal, and one of the reasons we have sort of this back and forth as to whether or not chivalry is dead and it's not, or we see women wanting to go back to that ideal, but still have all the benefits of the new ideal, still want, to be independent, strong, independent women, but yet they want men to still solve their problems and be, and align themselves with the old way, is because it's still trying to figure out how to force men into that. And again, the reason you think that the red pill is a cult, the reason that you think that game is threatening to your, to moral men, to morality. I've gotten many different arguments about this. Like, oh, game is, or people say, well, red pill, parts of it are Christian and parts of it aren't, like the game part, spinning plates, da, 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 da. Well, the reason why game is threatening to moralistic men is because it shakes up their belief in a romanticized version of Christianity. So you get guys who will like self-deprecate. Like I've talked about this with Pat Campbell before, where you get guys who will be like, they're introducing their wives and they're, oh, my bride, I can't believe that she would fall for a guy like me. I'm such a schmuck. I'm such a loser. Oh man, God must have really had me. I don't know. It was just divine providence that she would actually ever have anything to do with a schmuck like me. Yeah, first of all, you just basically insulted your wife. But why do guys reflexively default to that? Because they think that they need to make her more. They need to live like that will make her feel good about herself. Like, oh, I'm lifting you up, right? By lowering myself, I'm lifting you up. That's a mistake. You want to confirm you're a beta chump? That's probably the best way to do it. But you've internalized, like guys will internalize that. I hear that from politicians all the time too, when they introduce their wives. Oh, I can't believe she's my strength. She's the real power behind the throne. I give it up to her. Yay. Yeah. Well, what that deference, that female deference that these guys have is part of that idea. Anyways, let's move on. All right, guys, I'll take your, close enough. Okay. So I'm trying to keep things on track today. So NB says, so feminism is the new religion. It controls law, business, and family. Yes. Yes. And yes. It is certainly a social control. Feminism has inserted itself into our mainstream religions. That's easy. That's some easier than others. Christianity was probably the easiest one to insert feminism into, and most guys don't realize that they codify and canonize the romantic love ideals within their own doctrine and in their own faith. So what happens is all of those things, now this might not be scriptural, but all of the things that align with the romantic love ideal within Christianity are emphasized. That's like when we talk about how, like when you read any holy text, right? You read the Quran, you read the Torah, you read the Bible, you read Bhagavad Gita, I don't know, whatever you're reading, right? It's subject to interpretation. And that interpretation is now modified or is influenced by the romantic love ideal. So what happens is that's how you get like, these pop psychologist guys who call themselves Christian psychologists, but what they're really doing is they're taking modern secular romantic ideals and inserting them into the interpretation of that particular text. So that's how you get like, relevant Christianity, where it's like, oh yeah, Jesus was a feminist. And there's nothing that in the Bible that shows that Jesus is a feminist, but it's all a matter of interpretation. And that interpretation is influenced by feminism. Okay. I'm going to scroll back through some of these here. I want to get to everybody today. I'm trying to keep things a little short and sweet today, guys. Italian dude says, where do you think a cultural shift will happen favoring men? Well, we thought it was going to be COVID, right? We thought it was going to be this is the end of the world. It's funny how we thought that a global pandemic or a global crisis or a war or a meteor hitting the earth would suddenly shift women back to being housewives, or at least looking for guys who are on the beta provider side of the hypergamous spectrum. Like, oh, now finally it's our turn. No, it's not, because women are still comfortable. They're still in, they still have all the conveniences they ever have. That's why women said, screw that. I'm not going to go cook food for him. I'm going to start my OnlyFans account. That's why they lean back towards that. They're looking for what's going to pay the bills. They're looking for security. If the guys doesn't represent security, then they'll go do it themselves. Oh, OnlyFans? Sure. I'll show my ass off. No problem. When will a cultural shift happen? Well, that's another aspect. And this is something I talk about in the, in the book is that a lot of guys will think that men need to step up, right? It's women are bad because men don't hold them responsible. Well, that only flies so far. And the reason why that never gets any traction is because it goes against the romantic ideal. It goes against romantic, courtly love, chivalry. So if I hold you responsible, if I'm a man and I go, okay, well, I'm going to hold this woman responsible, it's not hip to do that. Right. I read, one of the descriptions I was putting into the book was, there's the idea of Hugh Hefner. Like, remember Hugh Hefner and Playboy came out right around the sexual revolution. He was in the right place at the right time and decided to build that persona for himself that he lived out. And maybe that was genuinely his persona, right? He was a Playboy. That's why they call him Playboy. But he was a guy that, because he was hip and cool, and because he was like the Dan Bilzerian, like, you see this guy and he's got money, he's got chicks, he's got, you know, probably got a lot of drugs too. But he's like the guy that everyone wants to be and all the women want to bang. And so if he says, and this, this is just an extreme illustration example, but if he says feminism is cool, you think feminism is cool. Women should be empowered. Oh, okay. Wow. Sounds good. And you will go along with those things so that you can be cool too. And that, so, well, if Hugh Hefner said that and he's got a lot of chicks, then I guess I should believe that too. And so that is guys, again, trying to solve, like, guys will do anything. We will adapt in any way possible, psychologically, physically, emotionally, behaviorally, whatever, if it will solve their reproductive problem. I've seen studies where, they indicate that men prioritize sex above food. So if it means I starve to death and I reproduce, so much the better. At least I tried. You know? When we see a cultural shift, I don't know. Not until we all recognize this. I think a lot of guys, I think sort of this MGTOW black pill fantasy is that if enough guys check out, then something will change and women will suddenly behave. That's not going to happen because women don't care about those guys. They care about the alpha guys because they can take care of themselves. Once they can't take care of themselves, then maybe something will change. That's why, unfortunately, we need a war or a crisis or something like that to kickstart that. Or we need an invention like the internet or something as a significant advancement in technology, knowledge, whatever, something that is radically shifts the direction of humanity. Some people keep saying that, well, maybe that'll be like male birth control. Maybe, but men still want to get laid. So are men, like, there'll be guys who will, like, if tomorrow, and people have asked me this, so I'm just going to hit cover this too. If people tomorrow created a hormonal, let's just say a pill, right? A magic pill that men could take, and as long as they keep taking it, they will never, you know, they won't, they'll still be horny. They'll still, it won't mess with your testosterone, like a lot of these things do, right? I know, I realize that Vasagel and there's other stuff out there right now. I get it. But a lot of it has side effects that basically kill your libido. So it kind of is shooting yourself in the foot. But let's just say, for sake of argument, that tomorrow we found this magical invention that said, okay, men, guess what? You have a pill now too. And now men and women are equally in control of the reproductive process. So if women want to have babies, they've got to ask men, give me a baby, please. I want a baby. All right. Well, that might change some things, but it's still not going to change men's nature. It's not going to change the way that we evolve and how we want to get laid. Men want unlimited access to unlimited sexuality. Pornography covers a lot of that, but let's just say you take away that card from them, or you make things a little bit equal. You equalize the playing field, because right now women have pretty much unilateral control over their, certainly the birthing process, the reproductive process. So as a result of that, they can go and bang whoever they want to bang. And they can, if they make a mistake, that's okay. Abortion's there. And if they can't find the right guy, the one, they freeze their eggs and, you know, go to the sperm bank. As long as there's sperm banks, that's male birth control is not going to make any difference. It's not going to, like, women will still have kids because they believe that they're better fathers than most guys are, because we keep ridiculing and demonizing and making men incompetent when it comes to, like, masculinity. Let's see. What else do I have today? Rollo, are you the guy in the Cancun story? Maybe. Joel says, are there cities in the U.S. in line with the red pill? I'm in L.A. No, I don't think so anyways. This is just me talking. I think it is on by an individual basis. There might be. Like people say, well, my culture is much more red pill than yours. I'm from Brazil. Or I'm from Dubai, or I'm a Muslim. I'm, you know, my family's not like that. In my culture, women respect men. Yeah, they'd probably do. You're probably right. Because mostly out of necessity, but you're probably right. But for how long? And then what are the conditions? What are the preconditions for you to be that guy, to be the guy that she wants to get with? Do you have to make her happy? Okay, the things that make her happy, are they the same as what make other women happy? That's a question you need to ask yourself. I don't know. I don't think it's a regional thing. Or even an ethnic or cultural thing right now. Although it might be to some degree, but it's becoming homogenous now because of the, you know, globalizing of everything. Can you seriously change happen? Well, the welfare state is so strong. Well, the welfare state exists primarily because of female correctness, right? Who are the biggest welfare recipients, men or women? Well, we used to call them welfare. Well, you're a welfare queen. Well, what I've seen happen, and this is just me. I'm going to give you my I'm going to put on my opinion hat right now. When women were inserted into the American westernized workplace, put into Western politics, put into positions of authority, the first thing women do is implement the feminine imperative. It's not about what's best for the rest. That's why it's not about what's right for the most amount of people. It's about what's right for women and womankind, again, because of the romantic ideal. Whatever benefits women is right. It is correct. And so like, finally, I'm in the Senate. I'm in the House. I'm in the Parliament. I don't know. Finally, we have a woman in there. What's the first thing she does? We need to legalize abortion. But we have all of these other problems over here. No. We need to legalize abortion. No. We need a no-fault divorce. Although that was Reagan that did that. But we need... all of these, we need things that are going to benefit. We need more welfare for single mothers. We need whatever it is, because what happened, and this is why I keep saying, and I will reiterate this one more time, is that I will never vote for a woman in any political office, because the moment a woman gets in there is not about what's best for the country or constituents or whatever. It is about what is best for the sisterhood uber alles. And you can see that in pretty much all legislature that most women, like you look at the, what do they call it? Alexandria Cortez, whatever her, you got all these female politicians. Why is like socialism even a topic in American politics right now? It's because the women are the ones that are part of the democratic socialists, right? It's because they're the ones that lean, like women naturally lean towards collectivism. That's just simply part of their evolved nature. That's what, when we were in hunter-gatherer tribes, women had to stay home and nurture the children and nurture a collective while the men were out hunting woolly mammoths or antelope. I don't know, whatever they ate back then. Paleo diet, right? And so men tend to be naturally meritorious. Meritus? That's why we get competition and dominance hierarchies. We reward men based on performance. It's a burden of performance. For women, it's even Steven. Everybody gets a share, because if we don't, then everybody dies. We want to keep everybody happy. We got to keep the unit. We got to keep the network together. And that worked. That was fine. Back in those days, that was great. Now we take that dynamic, we put women into leadership roles. They use that natural social, that's why socialism is a big deal. That collectivist ideal is transferred into their political decisions. Well, what is that? Well, thinking like a woman means that we're going to think in a collectivist way. And socialism tends to be collectivism. So that's why you get Alexandria, AOC, whatever her name is. I'm going to back through here. I know you guys got new ones. Just give me a break here. Aaron Frank says, how to deal with the regret of telling my best friend guy I am studying your TRM work. He was very skeptical about red pill stuff. Okay. Now, Aaron, I've always said this. Don't be a red pill evangelist. Don't try to preach the red pill. Otherwise, you'll get ass hats and say, oh, your red pills are cool. What I tell guys is you have to look at unplugging men from the matrix as triage. So save the ones you can and read Last Rites to the Dying. There's some guys that are never going to get it because they're too dependent on the blue pill. They're too dependent. Like their existence depends on them believing and serving women and being, again, the romantic ideal, all of that stuff. And if there is even a challenge to that, it is akin to you trying to convince them of a different religion. Like the guy was just asking me a second ago, well, is feminism a religion? Yeah, it kind of is, but it's a secular religion. It's a humanist religion. It is a religion of women, by women, for women. And men are the accessories to that. They're the facilitators of that. And it has been seeping into mainstream religion for a very long time, although most guys don't realize it. And I don't have any delusions that I'm going to change their minds about it. But what you'll probably want to do is, like most guys, they'll read my book or they'll get into, not even read my book, you could get into just, red pill stuff, or you'd get into forums or whatever, and you start hearing these ideas and you want to go, man, I want to save my brother. He's going to go marry this bitch. Well, you don't want to hear that because he figures, especially if he doesn't care, like people kept saying, Rollo, we need to get Prince Harry, the rational male. Like, awesome. I'd be happy to talk to him. Let's do it. But I don't have any real hope that that's going to change him, because his existence is dependent upon what his beliefs are, and to the point where he'll sell $50,000 of his rifles and his best, funnest hobby and blow off his brother and blow off his family. That's exactly what I did. That's exactly what I did with my BPD girlfriend. I can remember. I remember having discussions with my brother at the time, my younger brother. And I told him, because I was hurting, man, I didn't know what to do. And he's just like, he didn't know what to do with me because there's just no talking to me. And it had to run its course. I had to fucking fall way lower than I was. I had to fall and I had to hit rock bottom. I had to get zeroed out and in a bad way. And all your friends are gone. Only maybe your family, because they have to, will talk to you. Because usually not only will the BPD separate you from them, you will do it yourself because you think that it's your duty. And that's what's happening to Harry right now. You want to know what's going on with Harry? That's what's happening. He's being systematically isolated. He has no friends. His brother can't talk to him. He's no longer a prince. He's abdicated his titles. What's he going to do? Go work at Subway? And what is he qualified to do? Fly helicopters. Cool. Go fly helicopters. She probably won't even let him do that. No, because you'll meet people and you'll go out and you party. No, no. Sell your guns. No, no. I don't want you around other girls. Isolation, isolation, isolation. Yeah. Can you be red pill and Christian? Absolutely. I think so. You can be red pill and you can be Muslim. You can be red pill and you can be Jewish. You can be red pill and you can be, Hare Krishna. Remember, I think people, when I get asked questions like that, can you reconcile red pill with religion? Lots of people do. Lots of people try. I think one of the premises I'm trying to do with this book is to at least, build a bridge. There's a lot of people who say, if you believe, like atheists, of course, will say, hey, you believe in any religion, that's not rational. Well, maybe not, but asking the questions are. That is rational. And I will probably, I've said this, and this is in the introduction of the book. I've said that, I'm going to step on a lot of toes with this book. I'm sorry to say, and not in a good way, because I think a lot of people, when they see my work, they say, oh, it's a rational male. And if you have no religious beliefs at all, you'll go, finally, sweet justification. Rollo's going to hammer and shit on religion. No, And then you've got like the other side will be the guys who are like, and it doesn't matter what religion, but be like, you know, Orthodox Christian, well, I don't, whatever. Ah, finally, Rollo's going to tell us that the red pill is really a Christian ideal. Well, the red pill is really, you know, part of, you know, Muhammad's teachings, you know, or something like that. Like, no, I'm not. And neither of those is true. But I'm trying to build a bridge between those ideas. And the main theme in that, of course, is romanticized chivalry. I probably have not done justice to that topic. You really have to read that particular part of the book. What else do I have in here? Oh, okay. I talked about that one already. Okay, let me keep going. Hang on. I got a $20 clip down here. And I know I missed your other stuff. I'm going to come back to it. I promise. I swear to you, I'm going to come back. Ah, there we go. Warrior race. Should both sexes understand each other's sexual nature? Yeah. And would it help to bring the sexes to choose a, to help the sexes to bring the sexes to choose a mate that will stay and raise a more successful child to survive in our changing world? Yeah, but see, here's the thing. What you're doing is, okay, so that's two parts of the question, and this is a good one too. So first part is, should both the sexes understand each other's sexual? Yeah, but that's not going to happen, because not so long as we prioritize emotion before we prioritize reason, and sex tends to happen in the emotional rather than the reasonable, the rational. When women have sex with a hot guy, it's not like, he looks like a great guy to breed with. I'm sure he would have superior babies. We you know, if I were to be pregnant, that's the guy for, I would want to send my genetic material on into the next generation. No, nobody does that. I've said this before. You do not reason a woman into bed. So it's an emotional situation. So yeah, I think it's valuable for guys to understand women's nature. That also is a threat. So if I say, well, women's nature is such and such, or even if you don't say, well, women's nature is this, you say, okay, well, what is, like, asking questions is offensive right now because it's based in reason. Why do women do that? You shouldn't ask those questions. Why? Because it's not true love. You know, why do women do what they do? That's one of the things that really is offensive about evolutionary psychology, is it asks really uncomfortable questions, and it should seem pretty obvious that we might have answers for, like in a moral sense or in an emotional sense, but we don't have it in a rational sense. And it's that rational sense that pisses people off. Again, why do people think the red pill's a cult or it's an ideology or whatever? Because the questions it raises and the conclusions that come, the dots it connects, go directly against those beliefs. And those beliefs tend to be rooted in, you know, whatever works best for the feminine. And if it doesn't, first of all, men think that, you know, they got to make women happier. They got to qualify themselves to women. But asking those questions is against that qualification. It disqualifies them by asking those questions. And so you'll get guys, that's one of the reasons why I think, you know, the red pill is so revolutionary right now, is because it's like, guys don't care. I don't care the questions I'm going to, that's why I did my books. I didn't care about it. I really, if you look at the first, like this book right here, if you look at the rational male, it's rooted in asking uncomfortable questions. I come to some conclusions in it, but those aren't the conclusions aren't offensive. It's the questions that are offensive. And then what else did you ask? You said, would it help to bring the sexes to choose a mate that will say, again, guys don't have standards. They should have standards, but we want to go with what's reproductively expedient, and women will always have higher standards for reproduction than men will. And you'll say, no way, man, I want to vet my wife perfectly. Okay. Well, that's fine. You vet your wife, but the chicks that you're banging, the girls that you have in rotation, and you know, however many that is, whatever your notch count is, I'm not saying that that's, you know, that I think I understand, like today we want to say, well, if I've banged 40 women, then that makes me at this level. And if I banged 100 women, it makes me at this level. And again, that is a parody, or that is a disqualification, because if you are like that, you are going against the romantic ideal, because the romantic ideal is one man, one woman. and it's true love. That's why I always say meaningless sex. That's why when guys throw that at me, they go, "Oh, you just had meaningless sex." Why do you think it's meaningless? I meant to bang everyone I banged. No, it's like, why is one kind of sex, or why is my mating strategy less legitimate than the romantic ideal? Because women actually have the same strategy in some cases. You know, they're banging as many guys as they can get through to find the guy who's the right one for them. Guys, it's just, you know, unlimited access to unlimited sexuality, and most guys can't do that. Now, they say that. They say, well, it's, you know, it's meaningless sex. They do that as a form of disqualification, but the reason it's disqualification, or it should be if it's disqualification, they think it's disqualification, is because you being able to exercise your natural innate mating strategy goes against the romantic ideal. Ha! I wish I could. I wish that was the way. I know a lot of guys, and maybe you're like, I'm just looking at your name here, Warrior Race. I know a lot of guys will say, well, you know, we need to have more, we need more white babies. We need to get our fertility rates up. I'll get this all the time from race realists. They'll talk about like fertility rates. And you're right. Yeah, they're in the tank right now. And you're right about the cause. It's because of, you know, westernized, you know, chivalrous romantic feminism, gynocentrism, is really the basis, the reason why we're seeing those things. Because now we make our, we legislate our reproductive policy according to the sisterhood, not what's, you know, not what works best for men. Think about it this way. Prior to the sexual revolution, a man and a woman had to come together to say, okay, we're going to form a family. Now we don't have to do that. That's out the window now. In fact, I'll quote Dalrock. Dalrock said that right around that time, right around the sexual revolution, we shifted from a marriage-based model of raising children to a child support-based model of raising children. And it would be nice if we could all just go, okay, well, we're all going to keep it in the tribe, and we're all going to focus on having more babies, but not so long as it is gynocentrism that is pulling strings for our sexual politics. So there you go. Hope that answers your question. I don't know if it does. Probably not. Rollo sucks, man. You won't tell me what I want to hear. How do I make women qualify to me at 18 in uni? You don't. So what do, right? Get yourself in shape. Okay. There's different, hopefully you're in shape. One thing I tell guys, and you're 18, so you kind of qualify for this. Like, I get guys who are like 15. Like, I used to, one of my favorite forums on the old social forums was the teenage, or excuse me, the high school forum. It was guys anywhere between 14 and 18 years old, and they would always ask me questions and stuff. And I would try to set them on the right track. I always told them, I said, look, you know, and I covered this in preventive medicine, in the timeline in preventive medicine, my second book, that when you're between the ages, say like 14 and 18 or 14 and 20, in that, maybe that's 4 to 6 year stretch, women don't, like girls, the girls your age in particular, girl, I don't want to call them women, girls your age don't care about your status. They don't care. I mean, maybe they like a little bit of money because you have a car. Okay. You can facilitate things, but it's very high school, as you probably know, high school is very Darwinistic. So women are look like the girls of that time, that in that age range, are looking for the quarterback of the football team. They don't care that he has leadership qualities. They just know he's hot. He's so hot. He's hot. Remember that part in Zoolander? Derek Zoolander is so hot. That Hansel is so hot right now. that's teenage girls right now. And remember, teenage girls also have access to the global sexual marketplace. So even though you might be the hottest kid in your school, she's looking at the hottest kid in a school 4 states away, and maybe she has something going on. Maybe she's doing, what is it, duets with him on TikTok, right? I know that's a thing. So I would say the best thing that you can do is certainly be a good performer, entertain women, and get yourself in shape. And then, not to say that that's your only thing, that that's the only focus you should have, but if you want to be successful with women going into uni, that's the first thing they're going to start looking for. They're not looking for your esoteric qualities. They don't care about your intelligence. They only care that you look good and you're fun and you're hot. and you look like you. Remember, in that particular time of a woman's life, it's all about alpha seed. If you want success with women at that time, that's what you have to do. Now, that doesn't mean don't develop yourself. That doesn't mean don't make yourself your middle point of origin. Doesn't mean, you know, don't go to school and start building your empire. Do that, yes. But if you want to be successful with women, then that's what they're looking for. There's your 2-pound answer. 2 pounds. What is your opinion on surrogacy for an option for men wanting to have children? If you got the money, I get this. The first time I had this question thrown at me, I was at the Man in Demand conference in 2015 in Las Vegas. And the guy said, what about artificial wombs? Oh, it's 2020. I don't see them anywhere. Where are they? Or surrogacy, right? Now, for guys who are filthy, filthy rich, you could probably do it. And I don't know if gay men, gay couples can do it, but it requires a lot of money. And that's another sort of downside. You want to think of an advantage that women have. There's one. All they got to do is go to a sperm bank, and now they're pregnant, and they can have a kid. That also perpetuates the feminine imperative, because it's so much easier for women to do that. Men can't do that. They can't incubate a baby. So they got to get somebody else to do it. Now, should you do it? This is what I told the guy, is no, because you're making the same mistake that single mothers do. And what single mothers have been told, the lie that they've bought into is that they can be everything to a child. They can be the best of the masculine and the best of the feminine. Now, single fathers do raise qualitatively better children than single mothers do. This is a statistical fact. If you don't believe me, go pick up the book by Warren Farrell called The Boy Crisis. He goes into it in very specific detail. And I know that will piss off a lot of women watching this, but it's true. Single men raise better children than single women. Now they'll say, well, it's socioeconomic, or they do this. Oh, what, for whatever reason. Yeah. Boy, it would be great if we could do that. But the problem is you can't do that in bulk. Most men can't do that unless they're a widower, or their ex-wife was a junkie and they got, sole custody, or the wife or the girl, the woman just wanted to, didn't want to kill the kid. So she still wants to party, and she just gave up custody. That child has a better shot at life if he or she has a single father than a single mother. Statistical fact. Sorry, but it is. And, I know women will be, oh, what are you talking about? I can be anything. Like Mother's Day is coming up on Sunday. I'll guarantee, listen to the sermons. If you go to church, if you're a religious guy, listen to the Mother's Day sermon and keep that in the back of your head. And then listen to the Father's Day sermon when that comes around, I think in June. Because those sermons build women up, as I was saying before. You can be everything to anyone, right? That's why I tell guys, don't do it. You're going to be a good, you'd probably be a better father than she would be a single mother, but you're still cutting something out of that kid. And that kid is looking for a feminine ideal as well, which he should find in a feminine mother, in a conventionally feminine mother. So he or she, I should say. And so I don't think, I think that you make the same, this is what I told the guy back in 2015, you make the mistake that women do. Well, that's fine. I'll just have my own kid and I'll do it myself. Don't you think that that's what they did? Don't you think that when a woman goes into the sperm bank, I can't find men because I can't find the right guy. I can't really won't do what I want. I'm going to do. I'm going to go get pregnant anyways because I really want to be a mom. They can do that a lot easier than you can, but it's still based on that same idea that you can be everything to that kid. Now, if you recognize that and you say, well, I'll get married later, or I'll have, I got to find some way to, give a two-parent experience in a one-parent family, maybe you do a little bit better. But I don't think that it's, and I will tell you the same thing I would tell a single mother, it's not fair to the kid. You need two parents, a strong conventional masculine and a strong conventional feminine. And that's how the kid learns a healthy balance between the genders. And remember, that kid most likely will be raised in a society that is feminine primary and will try to influence him or her as to what is an ideal masculine and ideal feminine, and it'll be always be a distorted, fucked up way. So, all right. God damn it. Now I'm at 2 hours. You guys made me do it again. I'm only going through these. If men got a prescribed form of birth control, things would change. Yeah, but probably not as radical as you think. Babies would go me via. I don't understand what the hell you're talking about, dude. But the principle is this: a lot of guys think that if we could just take birth control away from women and put it in the hands of men, things would change. Yes, Little Roy, BPD is borderline personality disorder. Go look it up on my site. I have a whole essay dedicated to BPD, borderline personality disorder. Sorry, I should have clarified that, guys. The idea that male birth control would radically alter the course of history. Maybe a little bit. If it met all the criteria for something that would fundamentally put birth control in the hands of men. But even if it did, that you would still have blue pill betas, and you would still have alphas. Anyway, you'd have the guys that women want to get with. You'd have alpha seed and beta need, and the beta guys would use that as game, just like anything else. I've talked about this in my poly episode, you will see that men, particularly blue pill beta men, would use that as a form of game. Go with me, have sex with me. I'll give you a baby. I'll go off the pill or whatever it is. I'll be happy to, right? And women go, oh, I want a baby. Let's see. What else? My God, you guys are hammering me today. And Harry Butthole shows up at the end. I knew it. Castro or Joel says, you've said it's not necessarily a bad idea to be beta. It is a bad idea to be beta, but in terms of sociosexual hierarchies, like I was talking about before, beta is preferable to being a delta or a gamma. Then you say women wanting alpha, how do you rationalize this if you are a beta? I wouldn't. Well, we need beta men. We need beta men in society. Beta men was built pretty much a good portion of what we sort of take for granted right now, because they have, this is the upside of the romantic ideal, I guess you could make a case for this, is that because Western romanticism has given men a framework within which they can find purpose, please the woman, they seek novel ways to do so. So if I'm a beta man and I can't compete with the alphas that women want to get with, then I've got to find ways to make up for that for the deficits that I don't have. Either I've got to, you know, grow another foot and a half, or I've got to find some way to make a lot of money or be a good long-term proposition. I've got to find ways to cover deficits. And in doing so, beta men channel that sexual energy into other pursuits. And those pursuits are usually at some point designed to make them a good reproductive choice. It's fading now, but why have we had socially enforced monogamy for so long? Because it worked in the best interest of beta men. It pretty much guarantees, that's why you have things like, that's the one of the parts of the romantic ideal is the soulmate myth. There's one person out there that's perfect for you. You'll just got to find him. Whether God preordained this woman to be in your life, or women will say the same thing. You know, they'd be 50 years old. I'm still waiting for the man God has for me. That's the romantic ideal. That's a monogamous romantic ideal. So when guys believe in that, that's why the soulmate myth is so kind of endemic, I think. I'm using soulmate myth as an extreme, but soulmate myth is used as a social convention to encourage men to stay on the plantation, right? To keep working hard, to keep going and make yourself the best. So when that girl finally comes around, you'll be ready for her. Meanwhile, women are on this cock carousel and like, oh, you're the one for me. So that's how things have worked out for a long time. So when you go and you look at the advancement, like we're in a rapid phase of technological advancement, but up to this point, all throughout history, you have beta men who are certainly not making any decisions or pulling any strings, but they're still reproducing because monogamy, because they believe that if they do the right things and they live up to the expectations of, well, society, a feminized society or romanticized society up until the sexual revolution, if they keep doing those things and they keep building and they keep making bridges and cathedrals and airplanes and, you know, and power plants and printing presses and all these other things, these great, you know, inventions of mankind. I mean, shit, we have hormonal birth control probably because a beta male said, wouldn't it be great if we could have sex and not have to worry about getting pregnant? Oh yeah, awesome. Wow, who are you? I'm the guy that created, you know, progesterone, whatever it is. You know, I'm the guy that created hormonal birth control. Wow, cool. You make a lot of money. Now you get, you get what I'm saying, is we need beta men. We do. We need them to keep the lights on. Unfortunately, women don't now, like, guys are getting upset with this because we're seeing the game. We're seeing how, like, particularly when red pill guys like me go and say, here's the game. You know, I don't want to play that game. Of course you don't. It's throwing things off. It's throwing off the romantic ideal that women have, you know, effectively used for a very long time. That's why they're struggling right now. They're struggling with the idea of men becoming aware, unplugging. You want to tie, you want a good matrix reference when you're plugged in, when you're in the, you know, when you're in the matrix, it's really that those beliefs keeping you ignorant to those beliefs. And then when you've taken the red pill, you're cutting yourself away from that system. That's why guys get antsy, and that's why they get nihilistic and despondent, because they don't know what to do with themselves outside of that system. And women hate it because it's removing guys more and more. Like, you want to know why the marriage rate is going down? You can go over to Better Bachelor and watch his red meat videos and tell you why it's so great that you are now enlightened. Well, that's fine, but it doesn't do anything for the fertility rate. It doesn't bring men and women together, because men are becoming aware, red pill aware, whatever you want to call it. They're being unplugged from, you know, because we have access to understanding things. We have, because of a greater knowledge right now and greater dissemination of that knowledge, guys get it. And the ones that don't, well, we call them cucks, right? We call them soy. They don't get it yet. They will, one way or the other. They're on the sharp end of the stick or not, they're going to get it. But we'll see. We'll see what happens. Let's see. Mr. C says, saw this in an article in the Daily Mail today, man being mocked for saying that men who lean in to the... Okay. Mr. C, thank you for your $10, but we're going to talk about this on Rule Zero on Saturday morning. So I will hold on to this, and I will answer this in particular on that, because what guys are doing right now is they're a lot of, particularly blue pill guys, are taking this and they're going, oh, those red pill guys, they think if you lean in, you're automatically, look, it's the mountain. The mountain is, you know, the whole mountain is a big, like power lifter dude who just lifted like 1,000 pounds, like did over 1,000 pound deadlift. It's freaking incredible. But oh, he's leaning in on a girl. Now, what that is that's blue pill guys taking red pill principles and exaggerating them to say, oh, this is ridiculous. They're just, you know, reveling in their bullshit, but that's how it works. I will answer that, I promise you, Mr. C, on Saturday morning. Oh God, you guys are doing wonders to my voice. By the way, my voice box has been hurting. I understand why, like, Pat Campbell has to take days off to, like, rest it. What did you think about Robert Greene talking about Jung's anima animus in his book of Law of Human Nature? I'll leave it at this, Randy. I have read it. I think that it is qualitatively different than 48 Laws of Power. 48 Laws of Power, Robert Greene had nothing to lose. That was his first book. He's like, screw it, I'm going to do what I want to. And there's a lot of truths in it, and it's still his seminal work. He has some other good ones, don't get me wrong. Like, I think all of his books are great, particularly Mastery is another really good one too. But I think in this one, he has become far more feminine correct. Like, he thinks more in terms of, like, not stepping on women's toes. Why are you, hold on a second here. Tiger the Brave. Okay, Tiger the Brave. Sam says, I appreciate the effort. But I've been missed for three. Okay, well, hold on, dude. I got you. Hold on. Hold on. Relax, Tiger. I got you, man. It's coming. Is this the one you want, man? Is it, are you beta if she aborts your baby? Is that what you're, is that the one you're asking me about? Are you beta if she aborts your baby? Well, put it this way. Hold on, is this? Keep doing these up. Plus, I'll try. Put it this way. Abortion is the ultimate expression of hypergamy. Nothing says he's not the right guy like the uncontested ability to end a man's genetic legacy in utero. So does that make you beta? I don't know. You have to answer that yourself. I think that's what you're asking me. Is that the one you're asking me about or what? Let's see. Can you? Oh, yeah, Phil, I'm going to get to yours too. Hang on one second. Let me go back to Phil's really quick. Let's see. Phil, I'm sorry, Phil. Phil said this, and I'm sorry for getting to you at the very end here, Phil. I was trying to back all the way back up. It says, can you knock out my skipped super chat from last thing? Okay, so it says, it was TRP and family members how to share red pill realizations if and when they're needed, especially about a guy's choosing to stay single. Okay, so here's my advice to you, Phil, is, again, it's the same thing I was saying before, is you can't be a red pill evangelist. And I know, like, a lot of guys will say, well, I want to help my friends out, or I get this all the time. Guys will say, well, my family knows that I'm single. I'm 38 and I'm still single, and I'm hitting my stride. I'm in the prime of my life. I'm right where I want to be. I have the best sexual selection I've ever had. And my mom, my dad, they want grandkids, you know, or my brothers are all married and I'm not. But I'm very picky because now I'm red pill aware. They were idiots, and one of them's divorced, or maybe they're in relationships, whether they're good or they're bad. The decisions that they made were made in ignorance. And I mean ignorance in the sense that they don't realize the game, and they don't realize they're not red pill aware. They don't understand intersexual dynamics. So how do you, I believe this is what you're asking me. So I have guys will say this all the time. And the best thing I can say is you still have to make yourself your mental point of origin. You don't want to, again, make your decisions based on what you think your family wants from you, because probably mom and dad are still operating from a blue pill perspective themselves. But how do you deal with that? How do you deal with the guys that are, you know, maybe it's your friends, maybe it's your brother or something. What I tell guys is this: when you want to unplug somebody who you care about, or if you're trying to, and you care about yourself, right? Maybe you are trying to explain what it is that you like, your reasons for your decisions for what you want. Don't turn it into some magical thing. Like, well, I'm just waiting for the right one. No, say, look, I'm aware of what's going on. I want a particular kind of woman. I want to, you know, this is who I am, and this is what I want to do. No, I'm not gay. You know, no, I don't have a wife, and maybe I won't. You know, men can have babies for a very long time. You could couch it in those terms if you think that that's what they want to hear. But I would say this is, look for instances in real life where you can present them with an example of what you like evidence, let's just say, of the red pill or of an intersexual dynamic. One of those things might be my Prince Harry. Like, I don't want to end up like Prince Harry. Look at him. Look what he did in his marriage. I don't want that. Why would I want that? You know, or why do you, or just simply ask. You use Socratic method, right? Ask questions. Say, why do you think Harry's like that? Let them come to that conclusion, especially if for guys that you want to unplug, or if they're people that you care for, ask them questions, wait for those opportunities. You can't beat them over the head with it. I mean, very few of them you can, but like, you can't, you're not going to, you need to lead them to the questions that you want them to answer for themselves. So when you see women like on OnlyFans, or when you see things happen, like, for instance, like I was saying before, like women reverting back to being, you know, Susie Homemaker in the time of COVID. Why? Ask your brother. Why do you think that is? Why do you think suddenly she's decided that that's a thing? Right? Should I look for a woman like that? Ask them, like put it on them. But in doing so, make those questions lead to your own conclusions, right? That's really what Socratic method is asking the question so people can follow your logic, so they answer it for themselves, and it makes it seem like they came to it on their own, when in fact you were asking the questions that you probably were asking to lead you to where you're at. Again, you can't lead a horse to water. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make them drink. But the way that you lead the horse to water is usually by pointing out evidence and information to them that maybe they don't want to see. Sometimes that's hard. All right. What else? Did I get you Tiger the Brave? I think that's what I think I got to you. Tiger the Brave. Oh, Valentino said, Rollo, which difference between alpha and a player? Again, go look at the, let's see the video that I did on I'm trying to remember which one I did. Go look at that. Go look at the alpha. I did the, what is alpha? Go look at that one. And then also, my last week's when I did an intersexual hierarchies, I talked about that a little bit. Alpha is a state of mind. Being a player is just sort of the behavior. Okay. Okay. I already answered that. I got to Muhammad. I got to Joel. Did I get to Aaron? How to deal with regret of telling my best friend. I got to that. Declaration. Can serious change happen when welfare state? Yes. Talked about that. Warrior race. Who else did I not get to? Make women qualify for me at 18. Andre, I talked to you. Joel again. Mr. C. I did get to Tiger the Brave. Okay, good. All right. And then let's see, Taylor says, keep doing these uploads. this isn't an upload. This is a live stream. That's why I get raked over the coals. But I like doing these. Randy says, what do you think about Robert Greene? I talked about that. And Eleanor Rigby. Rollo, have you ever read Great Expectations by Charles Dickinson? Yes, I have. It is a red pill lesson manual about female nature written about 200 years ago. I can go one better than that. There are, when I was looking at chivalry and romantic love, there are treatises of the time back then that would be very much in line with red pill awareness that ended up getting sort of pushed down and then in favor of like poems and courtly love and stuff as well. I do agree. Let's see. Tiger, was that the one you wanted me to answer? I hope so. Okay. Ollie. Where's Ollie? Great video. Can't wait for the fourth book. Good. I'm glad. Yay. You guys are going to love it. I think you guys, this is a deep dive for me. Ollie says, surely if we condemn women for being easy while also telling men to bang different women until 35, we're being hypocritical. Okay. But here's the thing, Ollie, is men and women are different. Okay. We have different imperatives. The reason why that's offensive to you is because you're still stuck in the idea that we need to fall in line with the female mating strategy, which is, oh, we got to find the right quality girl, right? Remember this, and this is a statistical fact, is that for women, when women have multiple sex partners, like I think anywhere between like 7 and 10, they have a lessened ability, let's just say, to pair bond and to have successful marriages. There's a higher incidence of divorce for women who have higher body counts, notch counts, whatever you want to call it. Okay, but the same thing does not happen for men. Men with higher notch counts report at least as much. There's no difference in marital happiness, no difference in divorce and incidents, things like that, unless the guy's like a consummate player, right? But for the most part, if a guy has, much more sexual experience than a woman, that's actually expected of the guy. That makes that guy a stud. That makes that guy somebody that's desirable because it's proven, it's social proof and it's pre-selection that women want that guy. And they say, well, that's a double standard. Well, you cry about the double standard only because you believe in a chivalric romantic ideal. One man, one woman. Well, while she's off banging other guys, well, you don't know about, right? But, you know, okay, so we can talk about that, and you say, well, it should be even Steven, but it's not, because men and women are different. We have different priorities, we have different mating strategies, we have different evolved firmware, right? Well, that's unfair. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's unfair. It's also unfair that women are the incubators of the next generation, and there's nothing I can do about that with respect to abortion and all this other stuff. That's unfair. It's unfair that once the sperm leaves my body, I have no right to it. I have no decision. I'm completely powerless. That's unfair, right? But if I say, well, you know, men need to explore their options and get experience with women, and then when they're ready, they can get then they'll have a better education in female nature so that they can make a better decision when they decide to settle down and have kids and whatever. That's unfair. Well, sorry. And them's the breaks, whatever. I think that's it. Did I get it? I got everything. Yay. Okay. Don't get me any more. I'm not going to take any more because we're at 2:20 right now. And I promised myself I wouldn't go past 2:30. All right, guys. So that is the end of today's show. I hope you guys liked it. My book is coming along swimmingly right now. Again, I am at the point in this where I'm cutting stuff out because I don't know what I want to. Technically, I could write two books for this topic, but I'm not going to. I won't subject you to that. Again, I've given myself a deadline for the end of this month. I hope I'm going to make that. I think I am. This is like no other book I've done. Some of the stuff that is in this book, I have, has been previously done on my blog, but I would say probably about 80 to 90% of it is original stuff. So, you guys are going to really dig it, particularly if you are of, you're not political, like if you're of a philosophical mind or whatever, or like the question has been thrown at me the longest has been like, can you be red pill? Like I got it here today, right? Can you be red pill and be Christian or Jewish or whatever? And I think a lot of people already think that they can. And I think that maybe they're right. I'm pretty sure you can be. Can you live that way is the next thing. Can red pill, the information, can the data, can the awareness, can intersexual dynamics and understanding of intersexual dynamics coexist with your religious convictions? I think in some ways it can, and in some ways it kind of challenges those. And in that case, you're going to have to find some way to reconcile those things. If you're not good at reconciling, like, you know, challenges to your ego invested spiritual beliefs, you'll still enjoy the book, but it's gonna really rattle your cage. So keep that in mind. Anyways, I will be on Rule Zero. That'll be Saturday morning at, as far as I know, it's 11:30 Eastern. It might be earlier. It's going to be on Ryan Stone's channel, so make sure you get on there. We're going to be talking about exactly what I was asked about today, about this, if you're leaning in, or does that mean you're beta? It's going to be basically misinterpretations of what the red pill talks about and how people sort of use that to, like, you know, to disqualify what red pill awareness is all about, or red pill dynamics are. So anyways, I hope you guys have enjoyed this. I certainly have. This is a really deep topic. Chivalry is not dead, but is dead in the terms of, like, is it something that guys really want to participate in? Chivalry's not dead. Guys will happily follow along with this. So Tiger, did I get to your question? Dude, I swear to God. Okay. So whatever. Tiger, if you want to email me, you can. I'll answer you. Anyways, I hope you guys enjoyed this, and I will see you guys I'll also be on Sunday, regular time. And that's it. So have a good one.